Hello, my friends. In the previous videos, I have talked to you about plants and how beneficial they are for our life. We can even meditate with the plants and be more mindful. Today, I want to talk to you about the secret life of the plants, what the cutting-edge science tells us about the plants' intelligence, their emotions, and their way of communication with other plants, animals, and human beings. The first one who actually talked about the soul of the plants 2500 years ago was Aristoteles. Today, we do not know for sure if they have a soul or not, but we can be sure that they have a kind of intelligence and they can communicate. In 1966, a CIA expert in lie detection, Cliff Baxter, did some experiments with plants. He connected the lie detectors with a dragon plant, and he realized that they actually talk. In this experiment, two identical dragon plants are side by side, and the one is connected with a palmograph. The other is about to be killed by a man who finds out that he will be the one in a lottery. The plant which saw the killer feels in danger, and when just this man is approaching it, it reacts strongly. And these are the signals received by the palmograph. In 2005, an Italian professor in the University of Florence, who is actually a plant neurobiologist — this term did not exist when I was in the university — he has done much research on the communication and the feelings of the plants. I'm totally amazed by his experiments and the things he has discovered. And here is some little sample of what he does.
But plants are also able to show a lot of movements. Some of them are very well known, like the flowering. It's just a question to use some techniques, like the time lapse. Some of them are much more sophisticated. Look at these young beings that it's moving to catch the light every time. And it's really so graceful. It's like a dancing angel. They are also able to play. They are really playing. These are young sunflowers, and what they are doing is they cannot be described with any other term. Start playing. They are training themselves, like as many young animals do, to the adult life, where they will be called to track the sun all the day. They are able to respond to gravity, of course, so the shoots are growing against the vector of gravity and the roots toward the vector of gravity. But they are also able to sleep. This is what a mimosa pudica. So during the night, they call the leaves and reduce the movements. And during the day, you have the opening of the leaves and much more movements. So this is interesting because the sleeping machinery, it's perfectly conserved. It's the same in plants, in insects, in the animals. This is a root apex growing against a slope. So you can recognize this kind of movement, the same movement that worms, snake, and every animals that are moving on the ground without legs, it's able to display. And it's not an easy movement, because to have this kind of movement, you need to move different regions of the roots and to synchronize this different region without having a brain. So we studied the root apex and we found that there is a specific region that it's here depicted in blue that is called the transition zone. And this region, it's a very small region. It's less than 1 millimeters. And in this small region, you have the highest consumption of oxygen in the plants. And more important, you have this kind of signals here. The signals that you are seeing here are action potential, are the same signals that the neurons of my brain, of our brain, it's used to exchange information.
Stefano Mancuso says that plants do not like to be touched. They react on that, like mimosa plants do. It is just that the movements of mimosas are so immediate and apparent than in the majority of the other plants. But when it comes to our own plants, slowly they get used to us and they recognize us. They understand we care about them and they do not react anymore. When I was in university, nobody was talking about this. I wish I was a student today, so I could work in this field. Then, in 2015, a German forester, Peter Wollenben, published a book, The Secret Life of the Trees. An amazing book, amazing. There he talks about the community of the trees in a forest, how they communicate and how they balance. One of the examples I would like to share with you is that in the savannas in Africa, when the giraffes go in the acacia trees to bite the leaves, the acacia emits aromatic molecules in the air to warn the rest of the trees in the around area. Then the other trees receive the message and send to their leaves a bitter substance. The giraffe does not want this bitterness in the leaves. That's why it does not eat a whole tree at once. Because the tree, after the first bites, emits these bitter substances to the rest of the tree. And the giraffe stops and proceeds to the next trees, but not the immediately next, because they have received the message. They proceed about 100 meters further away, and even they proceed against the wind to the trees that they have not received the message. So much is the intelligence of the trees and the animals. Actually, the plants are the 82.4% of the biomass on Earth, according to a latest published research. Somewhere down here on the right, it is the animal kingdom, which is only the 0.4% in total. And we humans, we are only the 0.01%. Did you know that in one handful of soil there are more microorganisms than all the people on Earth? Sometimes I listen that the blue whale is the biggest creature on Earth, but actually it's not. The sequoia tree is. Some scientists even believe that the mitzes is the biggest microorganisms because they go through the soil and it's one organism. The mitzes that lives under the Black Forest of Germany extends in 1,000 square kilometers. Do you still believe? we are the most intelligent creature on Earth? Plants were on Earth long before us, and they for sure be here long after we have gone. Maybe we have to open our eyes, open our perspective, and see beyond our nose. Just because they are different, it does not mean they are not intelligent beings. They may have chosen to root in one point, but their seeds and their pollen are traveling kilometers away. And even if we mainly think of them as non-moving organisms, they make many and beautiful movements. But they are very slow, and our fast way of living is preventing us from noticing them. Today, with the help of the new technologies, we can now admire them. Here we see in fast forward motion movements that the plants needs many days to complete them. Plants can see without eyes. They can hear without ears. They smell without nose. They feel without skin. And indeed, they can talk without a mouth. During the last years, much research is done in order to understand the way plants communicate with each other and with us and with animals. And I'm pretty sure that in the future, science will prove that they communicate with us even through quantum field, through thought. This is why I tell you to meditate with a plant. Try to feel it. And the more we try to feel it, the more new neurons we produce in our brain, and the more easy it will be to communicate. We were brought up with the belief that we cannot communicate with plants. But what if we had brought up with a different belief that we actually can? Science in the future will show the truth. If you like this video, subscribe and press the bell not to miss my new videos. I study the cutting edge science and I give to you what I think that make us more mindful and what will help us in our evolution journey on Earth and in the universe. Until my next video, I send you all my love and a big hug through the quantum field.